Welcome back to Mad Medicine. In this lecture, we're going to be discussing SSRIs and SNRIs. Now, for the next couple of videos and for the next couple of lectures, we're going to be talking about antidepressants in general and the different classes. Now, if you guys don't know, on our YouTube channel, you can find this lecture as well as all of our other psychiatry lectures. Just go to youtube.com/madmedicine, and there you can find different lectures for the USMLE Step 1. You can also see different pharmacology lectures that we're going to be making. Now, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel while you're there. And with that being said, let's dive deep into it. And before we talk about the drugs, we're going to talk about depression, aka the big sad. So the big sad is a mental health disorder that's characterized by a persistently down mood where people have a loss of interest in their activities, and usually this is going to cause significant impairment in their day-to-day life, okay? You guys probably know someone who has depression, or you've probably dealt with someone in a medical setting who has depression, and if you have, you definitely know that depression causes significant impairment. It is a sort of debilitating disease to a certain extent, and it can get really bad, and some people obviously commit suicide based off of simply their depression. So this is all caused by a multifactorial component, right? You have genetics that's definitely playing a role. You have biology and in the environment, as well as psychological factors that are all playing a role in someone's depression. So it's not just, you know, a simple disease. It's a multifactorial disease. And the risk factors for getting depression are personal or a family history of depression that keeps you at a higher risk. Definitely, that's one of the things. A major life change, like a death in the family, a death of the loved one, a divorce, that can cause it. Trauma or stress in general that can lead to depression. Certain physiological or certain physical illnesses and medications also can cause it. So let's just write i.e. cancer. Cancer can definitely cause someone to go into depression because such a dangerous disease, or it's such a dangerous condition to have, and it often leads to death in certain cases. Now, depression is associated with many things, but the main things you need to know when it comes to a neurotransmitter level is that it's associated with a decreased level in serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. And these are the main targets of the drugs we use to treat depression, right? Because what you want to do is you want to increase the levels of all of these neurotransmitters in order to relieve a person's depression. Now, when it comes to treatment, there are multiple things you can do, and usually a multi-pronged approach is used to treat someone's depression, ideally. Not always. You'll see in the clinical setting, sometimes physicians just prescribe antidepressants and see. But usually it's cognitive behavioral therapy and antidepressants, and that's what you need to know for step one. These are the main things you're going to use. Now, when it comes to the antidepressants, you have many options. So you have SSRIs, SNRIs, you have tricyclic antidepressants, you have monoamine oxidase inhibitors, and you also have the atypical antidepressants. So we're going to be talking about all of these drugs in the upcoming lectures as well. But today, in this lecture, we're going to be discussing SSRIs and SNRIs. So with that being said, let's dive deep into the discussion, and let's start off our lecture, or well, let's start off the content of our lecture with SSRIs. SSRIs are selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. So the main function of these drugs is to block the reuptake of serotonin in the synaptic cleft. So when you have the synapse right here, this is the presynaptic neuron. Okay, this is your synaptic cleft, and right here you have the postsynaptic neuron right here. So usually if you have serotonin floating around, it's going to get taken up. SSRIs are going to block this reuptake of serotonin, and it's going to allow for more serotonin to be available in the synaptic cleft so it can have a greater effect. Okay, simply because these people, the patients who are suffering from depression, have a decreased amount. So we're not really increasing the amount of serotonin that your body is releasing. You are just reducing the time it takes for serotonin to be reuptaken. And in order to do that, you block the reuptake, and that causes an increased effect based off of the limited amount of serotonin you actually have. So certain examples or certain drugs that you definitely need to know are going to be these drugs, okay? commit these drugs to memory because these are very important medications. Fluoxetine is the main drug that you might see, but you can also see fluvoxamine, paroxetine, sertraline, escitalopram, and citalopram. Now, these two drugs you definitely need to understand because the suffix pram is definitely different than the rest of them. So if it ends in teen, T-I-N-E, amine, amine, like fluvoxamine, or sertraline, okay? Teen and teen, lean, amine, and pram. That's the way I always remembered SSRI drugs. Now, if you see them enough, you'll just commit it to memory naturally. But what I highly recommend you guys is start writing these out just so you can remember the drugs. Now, like I said, they inhibit the reuptake of serotonin in the synapse, and this leads to increased 5-hydroxytryptamine. That's what 5-HT stands for, 5-hydroxytryptamine or serotonin levels in the synaptic cleft. Now, you're not releasing more serotonin than you normally would. You're releasing the same amount constantly, but what you're doing is you're preventing the reuptake as fast as it normally would, and that leads to an increased amount over time. Okay, now the one thing you need to know for SSRIs, it usually takes 4 to 8 weeks for them to start working. When it comes to USMLE, and maybe even in real life, when you provide an SSRI, you're going to see that after you prescribe a drug, you usually have a follow-up appointment for the patient to come back in 2 weeks just to see how they're dealing with the drug. Have they been taking it? Have they been compliant? And both at the USMLE level and at like real-life level, a lot of times patients will say, you know what, I don't feel any different, nothing's happening. And that's because it takes 4 to 8 weeks for SSRIs to start functioning properly, and you need to inform the patient, just keep taking them, they're going to start working, it just takes a little bit of time for them to kick in. And SSRIs are used in many, many disorders. So not only depression, right? Depression is the main one you think about, but also generalized anxiety, panic disorder, OCD, bulimia, nervosa, anorexia nervosa, PTSD, as well as premature ejaculation. Okay, we're going to talk about this one in a second, and we're going to describe why. But pretty much what ends up happening is SSRIs are, in my opinion, the quintessential drug that you can always choose if you don't know what to choose. So if you have a question where you don't know what drug you want to give for a certain disorder, most often than not, it's going to be SSRI. Okay, so if you're just a betting person, if you're a betting man, I would go with SSRIs and then, you know, see if you won the bet. So clearly what I'm trying to tell you is that it's used in majority of the disorders when it comes to step one psych cases. Now, there are several side effects you need to be aware of. The first one and the most important one is called serotonin syndrome. This is a psychiatric emergency where you have increased levels of serotonin, and it can lead to several adverse effects like carcinoid, similar to a carcinoid tumor. Okay, and carcinoid tumor occurs in the GI tract, and it usually releases a lot of serotonin, and it can lead to serotonin syndrome. This is going to be, it's going to give you symptoms like flushing, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting. It's very non-specific symptoms that shouldn't be happening when someone is taking an SSRI. You're going to need to look for the levels of serotonin, right? And it's usually increased. Now, this can also lead to GI distress, weight gain. SIADH, syndrome of inappropriate ADH, is rare, but it can occur, as well as QT prolongation. That's also very rare. I think this is lower on the gamma when it comes to step one, but you should just know about it. And the last thing you definitely need to know, okay, this is the high yield stuff that's in red, is going to be sexual dysfunction. A lot of people who take SSRIs have to deal with sexual dysfunction, like anorgasmia. 36% of patients have that. 54% of patients complain about a decreased libido. And then 37% of patients complain about erectile dysfunction. So that's why you can see the sexual dysfunction portion might actually be good for premature ejaculation, because you are reducing the threshold for someone who ejaculates quickly, right? It's going to take them longer because of the sexual dysfunction side effect, which in this case might be a preferential side effect. So that's definitely very important for SSRI. So just to quickly make sure you guys understand, just to do a quick brief recap, right? SSRIs are going to do exactly what their name says, block the reuptake of serotonin, right? It takes 4 weeks for them to start working. They use in majority of psych cases, you can use them. And the key things to watch out for step one, it's gonna be serotonin syndrome, similar to carcinoid tumor. And in that, you're gonna see patients who have flushing and diarrhea, and they just don't feel well because they've been taking too much SSRIs, or maybe they have a carcinoid tumor and they're taking an SSRI and it's affecting the same. It's just upregulating the amount of serotonin they have. And then finally, you want to watch out for sexual dysfunction, which occurs in a lot of patients, a very common side effect. Now, when it comes to SSRIs, we're not just done there. You also need to know certain aspects of certain specific SSRIs, okay? So we're going to talk about these specific SSRIs. Number one, fluoxetine has the longest half-life, okay? Fluvoxamine is the only main SSRI that's approved for OCD. So for OCD, fluvoxamine is the drug you want to use, okay? Paroxetine has the shortest half-life, meaning it stays the shortest in your body, and withdrawals can occur a lot easier with paroxetine than it would with fluoxetine. And then finally, sertraline has the highest risk for GI upset occurring. Keep in mind, in the previous slide, we talked about one of the side effects being an upset stomach, and sertraline is most likely going to cause this. Now, one last thing, this is pretty important, just in general, you should know that there is a 1 to 2% risk of increased suicidal thoughts in patients who are less than 25 years old who are taking SSRIs. I thought that was very interesting, so I put that in there. I don't know if it's going to come up on step one. It might later on, but it's just something you should have in the back of your mind when you're prescribing SSRIs to someone who's less than 25 years old. You want to let that patient know you could have suicidal thoughts. It's pretty rare, 1 to 2% chance. Right, but you do want to know that those patients can have suicidal thoughts. So if they come to you and they say, hey, I've been having suicidal thoughts, more so after I've been taking this drug, you know why. Okay, and for that, we don't know the mechanism of action. Now, the next drug, or the last drug in this lecture, is going to be SNRIs. SNRIs are very simple or very similar to SSRIs. They function the same way, except that this is a serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. It blocks serotonin and it blocks norepinephrine. And the main SNRIs you need to know are gonna be venlafaxine, desvenlafaxine, duloxetine, levomilnacipran, and milnacipran, okay? So the way I remembered it is I remembered milnacipran, and milnacipran is already in levomilnacipran, so that's one SNRI. Venlafaxine, okay, lafaxine is the next one. And then the one that always would throw me off, I would get it confused with an SSRI, is duloxetine. Because remember, sertraline, fluoxetine is a SSRI. Duloxetine sounds very similar to an SSRI, because of the T-I-N-E suffix, but just keep in mind, duloxetine is a SNRI, okay? And the reason I'm stressing all of this is because in psych, a lot of the medications overlap with their suffix. So you may try to find, you know, an easy way to figure out which drug is what type of class based off of the name. And often it works, but for the exceptions, okay, and this goes across the board for step one, for the exceptions of these drugs, you need to know what they are. So for example, in SSRIs, you can use the T-I-N-E suffix. Most of the time it's fine. But you need to watch out for duloxetine, because duloxetine is not an SSRI. In fact, it is an SNRI. So duloxetine, SNRI. I'm just nailing that home so you guys don't forget it. Now, we talked about this. They inhibit the reuptake of serotonin and norepinephrine, and it leads to both serotonin and norepinephrine levels increasing in the synaptic cleft. And this also takes 4 to 8 weeks, no matter what. Okay, both of them have the same onset of function when it comes to our brain. And again, these are also used in many of the same disorders as SSRIs are used in. So you can kind of use them interchangeably. But the main things you need to know, other than just these disorders, is that duloxetine, okay, the one SNRI that sounds like an SSRI, duloxetine is used to treat fibromyalgia, and venlafaxine is used to treat diabetic nephropathy. Okay, these two drugs have other side effects. They're also used for diseases other than psychiatric diseases. Now, the side effects are also going to be very similar to SSRIs, like the serotonin syndrome, but you're going to get hypertension because you're increasing norepinephrine, right? Keep that in mind. In this case, you've increased the levels of norepinephrine, so that can lead to hypertension. You're going to get nausea. You will also see, you'll also see sedation in certain cases, as well as sexual dysfunction. And this is the highest with venlafaxine. So if someone is using venlafaxine, you want to watch out for sexual dysfunction. And with that being said, that's everything you really need to know about SSRIs and SNRIs for step one. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you so much for listening to our lecture. And if you guys don't know, you can find these podcasts on your favorite podcast service for free. Just search Madden Medicine and we'll pop up. Thank you and continue on to the next lecture.